Preparation for the Word of God today, let us read or recite. We'll recite together, please.
All Scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training. Lord, may I hear and receive your word today.
This morning, our text again is in the fifth chapter of Ephesians. Our emphasis is verses 3 through 7. We spotlighted the first two verses last week. We'll look at the first two verses and review and move into the meat of this text. Now, it's very important that as we as Bible students, we understand what we're going to do is we're going to read the text and we're going to live from the text what the author is saying to audience here in our text, and last but not least, bring application. Application is the last thing that we do after we have made observation. Our observations include whom the author is talking to and the circumstances surrounding his conversation and why it's necessary for him to say what is being said. Then we bring out application. This is one of the most misinterpreted passages of Scripture in the book of Ephesians. Let's look at the first two verses again. Paul begins by saying, therefore, be imitators of God. Be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. We noticed last time the word therefore connects us with the last few verses of chapter 4, as he has shared with us attitudes and mindsets regarding our behavior one to another. In order to be kind and tender-hearted and especially forgiving each other, just as God in Christ forgave us. The only way that can be done is through the power of God. So Paul instructs his audience to be imitators then of God. Notice those two statements. They're parallel. To imitate God is equal to walking in love. And as we stated last week, the entire Christian life, I believe, could be summed up as a life of imitating God as his beloved children as we walk in love. We cannot possibly imitate God without first of all knowing him, without knowing his attributes and who he is. So therefore, time must be spent in the Word of God, because the Word of God is our only reliable source of information concerning God, concerning his attributes, concerning the one whom we are to imitate. Paul says, since you are God's dear children, imitate him. The basis for imitating him is the fact that we are his beloved children. That's our identity. We are God's children. We are the children of God. We are therefore to do as he does, speak as he speaks, think as he thinks. This means that we should not get involved in the sins that Paul will list from verse 3 on. Paul turns the theme from a self-sacrificial love in verse 2 to its extreme opposite in verse 3. Verse 2, he's talking about a self-sacrificial love, the love of God. Verse 3, he talks about a self-indulgent lust. which is the total opposite of a self-sacrificing love, a self-indulgent lust that centers around sexual sins that Paul speaks heavily in verse 3 and 4. These verses, Paul is simply expanding on the teaching of our Lord. God's intention for man is either marriage with complete faithfulness to the partner or total abstinence from sex. The Bible allows no deviation from these. But sad to say, many Christians today, many who wear the title of Christians today, have abandoned the belief that Christians are to live differently than the world. It says in verse 3, but immorality or impurity or greed must not be even named among you, as is fitting, as is proper among saints. But immorality or impurity or greed must not even be named among you, as is fitting. Some Bible says, as is proper among saints. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. But immorality or impurity or greed must not even be named among you, as is fitting, as is proper among saints. First of all, look at the word but. Look at this conjunction. We have to compare. It's a comparison. It's a comparison to what he has just said in verse 2 to what he's now going to say in verse 3. And what is Paul saying? Paul is saying is that this type of sexual sin is a violation of the God kind of love. He's saying you cannot truly love one another in the biblical sense and practice sex outside of the boundaries of God. This is what he's saying to his audience. Now, don't go lifting from the text and giving application right away to us. We will get there. Let's understand what is he saying to this pagan Greek Jewish culture. He's saying that sexual sins outside of the boundaries of God, in a biblical sense, cannot express biblical love. Mm-hmm. It's impossible. Mm-hmm. They are mutually contradictory. Therefore, Paul is saying, you can't combine the two. You have to see what's in verse 2 and what's in verse 3. Look at the first word, but. No such thing as sexual relations outside of the boundaries of God that's done in biblical love. This is what Paul is saying. Now, I have to say a few words about the culture in which Ephesus is experiencing at this particular moment that Paul is writing. We're told that the city of Ephesus that Paul is writing to was noted for its moral corruption. It was noted around the world for its moral corruption. They had the temple there which offered, we are told through history, ritual prostitutions as being a part of its worship service. Ritual prostitution. Ephesus was known to be a city full of cults and prostitution as they practiced their religion. And Paul is speaking to individuals who had been rescued from the cesspool and brought into Christianity. But coming into Christianity, they bring their old lifestyle. I was privileged yesterday to spend a great part of my afternoon with one of my fellow ministers in the gospel, and I believe he just wanted to talk. And I happened to be the ears upon which I was privileged to him talking. When I came away, when I left that scene, some hours afterward, and as I was driving home, I began to think how steep tradition is to some people. Tradition. We want to operate by the Bible. We want to claim that the Bible is the sole authority of God's Word. But yet still, there are traditions in the church that it's hard for some to let go. So the question was asked to me, Jake, what do you do when these traditions keep sticking up the heads and people want to continue to practice in their traditions? What do you do? I said, well, we are instructed to do one thing only. Preach. Preach. Preach the Bible.
Amen.
Preach the Bible. I can't change nobody's mind in here. I can't change your thinking in here. Only thing I can do is study the Word, explain the Word, present the Word, preach the Word, teach the Word, and allow the Holy Spirit to do the rest.
Amen.
And so individuals coming into the church of God in Ephesus, and they had been born into, they had been practicing, they had been operating for numbers of years, practically for some, their whole lifestyle in this type of worship that included sexual immorality. They were coming into the church. They were coming with this mindset. Now you have to understand, when we are saved, it restores our relationship back with God. But it doesn't clean up immediately all the mess that we have been in and all the mess that we have participated in immediately. That's the work of sanctification, which takes place as we continue to learn about God and study His Word. It comes over time. So instead of Paul just kicking these individuals out, Paul is going to preach. He's going to teach, but I want you to know this is yet a command. This is not a suggestion. This is a command. And he's dealing with their attitude that they are bringing into the church of God. Our culture is very immoral today. Our culture is very immoral.
Amen.
We live in a very immoral culture. But you know what was sad about it? Most Christians don't think so. Our culture has done a good job in selling us its immorality until it has, in most cases, become normal. For the church. And when I say the church, I'm not talking about the institution that Jesus said that the very gates of hell would not prevail against it. That's not what I am making reference to. I am making reference in part to the people who go to church, who are the individual church. And for the most part, because of tradition and because of a lot of other ingredients that have been thrown into the cesspool, for many who go to church, we do not have the same values that are presented in Scripture. Our culture is very immoral. That would include many who go to churches now are very immoral. We saw one today as we were heading to church, trying to pass everybody on the road, leaving whatever they put into the parking lot and get to church.
We go to church with an immoral attitude, an immoral thoughts coming from immoral practices, sit through services, sing songs, read scripture, hear a message from the church, and leave to go back to a place of immorality. Paul is simply sharing that for the church, we're to be different.
Amen.
We're to be different. We're to be different. We are not to imitate the world. We are to imitate God.
Amen.
I want you to see what God said to Israel. Turn to Old Testament. Leviticus chapter 18. Leviticus chapter 18. Leviticus chapter 18. I want to read the first three verses. Then we're going to skip down a few verses. Leviticus chapter 18, verses 1 through 3. You having located it, I will begin to read. Then the Lord said, or spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the sons of Israel, and say to them, I am the Lord your God. And you shall not do what is done in the land of Egypt where you live, nor are you to do what is done in the land of Canaan, where I am bringing you. You shall not walk in their statutes. There, whom? The land of Egypt and the land of Canaan. They have statutes. They have values. They have a way of living. And you say, you are my people, and you are my people. You will not live like where you came from and not where you go. I have a different lifestyle.
Amen.
Then he begins to list of sexual sins that Israel is to avoid. Now skip all the way down to verse 24, where God says to them, do not defile yourself by any of these things. That's what he said previously above verse 24. For by all these the nations which I am casting out, which I am, God is casting out before you, have become defiled. God said, I'm going to do something on your behalf, Israel, because they have defiled themselves. For the land has become defiled. Therefore, I have brought its punishment. I, God, have brought its punishment upon it. So the land has spewed out its inhabitants. But as for you, Israel, but as for you, the children of God, the ones that I have brought out of Egypt, the ones that I'm bringing into Canaan, but as for you, what are you supposed to do? You are to keep my statutes. You are to keep the statutes of God. You are to keep my judgments, and shall not do any of these abominations. Neither the native or the aliens who sojourns among you. If they're in your company, if they say they are with you in your household, they shall not operate in the cesspool that you have left in Egypt and in the cesspool that you're moving into in Canaan. What did Israel do? Did Israel follow God's instructions? No, they followed the immorality of their neighbors. And it cost them dearly. It cost them. Now, in the New Testament, where we have just began to study the fifth chapter, we learn in the fourth chapter, the church has been given a command that's similar. We were told in the fourth chapter, you remember these words, walk no longer just as the Gentiles who also walk. And then he gave us a list of how the Gentiles walk. And he has told them, you don't walk like this. Why? Chapter 5, verse 1, you are to be imitating God. And you're walking like this, you are imitating the Gentiles. Walk like God, act like God, imitate God. How is God? God basically is holy. What are you supposed to do? We have to be holy.
Yes.
Let's get to our text. Let's get to our text. In verse 3, Paul lists three sins. Three sins. And I believe that all three of these terms have to do with immoral sex. Mm-hmm. Now we know that we are basically sexual beings. God created the human race in two sexes. In two sexes. Mm-hmm. In two sexes. Not one, two.
Amen.
Sex is an important part of life. It's designed by God to add flavor and excitement to our relationships within his boundaries. The first word that Paul uses, notice what Paul says in verse 3. I'm going to walk through this. But immorality. Immorality. Stop right there. But immorality. Comes from the Greek word in the New Testament, porneia. Porneia. Which the translations have translated to say immorality in most translations. So the first question we need to ask ourselves as we look at this text is, what is porneia? Go to Matthew 19 and verse 9. Go to Matthew chapter 19 and verse 9. Do I have somebody? Is somebody tracking with me?
Amen.
Matthew chapter 19, verse 9. Now notice what Jesus says. Jesus says, Jesus speaking to his audience. Who is Jesus' audience here in Matthew? It's not the church at Ephesus. Who is Jesus' audience in Matthew 19? It's not the church at Galatia. He's speaking to Jews. He's speaking to religious Sadducees and Pharisees. He's speaking to primarily Jews as his audience who come to trap him concerning some Jewish matter. He says, and I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, so the subject is going to be divorce, whoever divorces his wife except for immorality, or if you're writing in your Bible, the Greek word for that immorality is porneia. P-O-R-N-E-I-A, porneia. The same word in our text today. Except for immorality, and marries another woman, commits adultery. So what does Jesus give us here? Jesus gives us the grounds for biblical divorce is porneia. So we must understand exactly, as much as we can, what this word means. What did the Jews think when Jesus said that if a man found his wife guilty of porneia, he could divorce her? Then we have to ask the question, what did it mean in Jesus' culture? Well, when we do word studies on this word in Matthew chapter 19, it basically comes from a term that's rooted in the meaning to sail. To sail. And it referred regularly in Jesus' culture to prostitutes or to the institution of prostitution. Over time, it has come to mean the one who visits the prostitute or the homeowner. And then over time, it has expanded to include or to be applied to adultery. But in Jesus' day, it specifically was making reference to sale. To sale. To sale. So Jesus says, except for immorality. One who is selling sex. One who is selling themselves. One who is operating in prostitution. That's the meaning of the term and what Jesus was saying of the sexual activity in his day. With a person who is not married. Man and a woman who would become physically intimate with each other and have sexual relationship would fit this definition of the use of porneia in Jesus' time. To be physically intimate with someone who was not their mate making physical contact with another person in a sexual way, is this word porneia in Jesus' day? Now, many believers today like to make the distinction between adultery and, we use the word fornication, which is another word that has been translated from this word porneia. Adultery, as is defined by many in the church today, is sex between married people with someone else other than their spouse. And fornication is sex between two unmarried people. But porneia, as given in our text, actually describes a much larger class of activities, more than just intercourse between unmarried folks and folks who are married but not to each other. In fact, it's the root word that we get our English word porno from. And it covers a broad class of behaviors as the porno industry uses today. So now, what can we find in Scripture? What does Scripture have to say about this word porneia, especially in the New Testament? How it uses it? Well, it uses it basically in four different ways in the New Testament. We find this word in 1 Corinthians 7 and 2, 1 Thessalonians 4 and 3. Here is the first usage. It is that voluntary sexual intercourse of an unmarried person with someone of the opposite sex. And then the second use is found in Matthew 5, 32, Matthew 19 and 9, where we have just read, and it becomes a synonym for the word adultery, which is sexual relationships with someone other than one's spouse. Revelations pick up this term in Revelation chapter 2, verse 14 and 20, as referring to the harlot or prostitution. And then last but not least, this term is used especially in the book of Romans and throughout the epistles as the variety of sexual sins, which include homosexuality and bestiality. So porneia is a broad term used to cover a broad form or spectrum of sexual sin. Notice what the Word of God specifically says in 1 Thessalonians 4 and 3. 1 Thessalonians 4 and 3. 1 Thessalonians 4 and 3. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that is, that you abstain from sexual immorality or sexual porneia. Clearly, God's will for believers is sexual purity. As he says again in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 6 this time, and that no man transgresses and defrauds his brother in the matter, because the Lord is the avenger in all these things, just as we also told you before and solemnly warned you. Now I want you to see something in that verse. Look at that word avenger. Who is the avenger? The Lord. The Lord. A very interesting word in the Greek, which means one who carries out legal justice or legal sentences. And he's talking to believers. God warns that he is the one who carries out legal justice or legal sentence against those who commit porneia. Now, I must say this, when we talk about the word commit here in the New Testament, it's not talking about someone who does it one time and only, but it's talking about one who has a lifestyle of this kind of behavior, who keep exposing themselves to this behavior, continue to practice these behaviors. Are y'all tracking with me?
Amen.
Notice what he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 and 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 and verse 2. Now concerning the things which about which you wrote, it is good for a man not to touch a woman, but, now concerning the things about which you wrote, talking to the Corinthian believers, it is good for a man not to touch a woman, but because of immoralities, here's our word, but because of porneia, each man is to have his own wife, and each woman is to have her own husband. I believe this verse of Scripture makes it clear about God's opinion about monogamy and homosexual marriages. Notice what the text says. Notice what the Bible says. But because of immoralities, let each man what defines a man from a woman? We got some grown ups in here. Y'all looking to be like a deer caught in headlights. Let each man, if you were born a man, let each man have his own wife. Now he's going to clarify the wife because he used the word there. And each woman is to have her own husband. So the wife is to be a woman.
Amen.
That's what the Bible says.
Amen.
I believe the Bible.
Amen.
So ain't no such thing as same-sex marriage.
That's right. Amen.
Because the Bible said, let each man have his own wife, and each woman have her own husband. It makes it clear. Paul says, the general sense is not good for a man to touch a woman, but because of immoralities, because of porneia, every man is to have his own wife, and every woman is to have her own husband. Then someone may ask the question, well, is this the reason why a person should marry? Well, there's one good reason. To avoid fornication. You should marry to avoid fornication. It's not the only reason for marriage, but it is one good one. Now, you got to understand, when Paul is writing this, Paul is not giving us his full doctrine of marriage. He's speaking of the danger of sexual sins in this particular chapter for those who are single. What Paul is doing here is answering a specific question to a specific problem that was given in a specific situation that was existing at the church at Corinth at that time, in which they wrote to Paul and asked Paul for his opinion. The situation was this: fornication was rampant in the city. Temptation was abandoned. Temptation abounded on every turn. A man could not walk down the streets of Corinth without being propositioned. What Paul is saying in this passage is that the real solution to the situation is Corinth is that to let every man have his own wife and let each woman have her own husband. God was the one who instituted marriage, and he instituted marriage as a safeguard for such evils. Marriage is never to be the lesser of two evils. Marriage is the God-ordained safeguard against the immorality that was existing in Corinth, and in our text, against the immorality that was existing in Ephesus. So Paul tells the Corinthians that in order to avoid porneia, they should get married. This would clearly tell us that sex among singles is porneia, is sin. Now, porneia is not limited to singles having sex, as we have just studied, but it includes singles. Now, before we move to look at another word in our text that Paul uses, let me say this. 1 Corinthians 5 and 1. 1 Corinthians 5 and 1. 1 Corinthians, what did I say?
1 Corinthians 5 and 1.
5 and 1. Paul says, there is fornication among you. There is fornication among you. That's all I want you to get. You see that? Now, I believe these statements is true in just about every church in America. That statement may seem a little strong, but I'm convinced it's true. Pornia has become so rampant in our church today that many of us cannot recognize it. We don't want to recognize it. We are exposed to it through the television, through the internet, through our telephones, through our sitcoms, through our comedy shows, through whatever we deem as entertainment for us as believers. For the most part, we think nothing is wrong with it. I, 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 God would branch out to say that there are those who are in this small audience today who feel like laughing at these matters is nothing wrong. Paul talks about that kind of jesting in our text today. That's one reason why I love teaching expository. I love just to go straight through the Bible. Mm-hmm. I ain't got to come up with no new subject. Mm-hmm. The Bible covers every subject that fits us. Mm-hmm. The only thing I got to do is read the text, mm-hmm. believe the text, explain the text, and mm-hmm. deliver the text. That's all. Now, the rest, you get mad with God. If we say we are Bible-believing Christians, we believe the Bible. The Bible is the authority. Then what does the Bible say? Renee is rampant in our church today. And we have to understand that God hates it and God judges this sin. We must understand the destructive nature of this sin, and we must put it to death. We must do all that we can to protect our children and grandchildren from it.
Oh, God, yes.
Let's move back to our text. That's how I'm going to get back to Ephesians. Let's go back to Ephesians. Now, we looked at the word, he says, but immorality. And we looked at that word is porneia in the Greek. And it has a plethora of meaning, from sex between unmarried folks to sex between married people who are not married to each other. That include homosexuality, bestiality. I mean, it has a plethora of activities. Now he moves on from there and he says, or any impurity. Now look at our second word. Our second word is impurity. Are you in with me?
Yes.
Now in the Greek, this word means cleansing. But it has a negative connotation. And the negative connotations to impurity would give us the words like filthiness, uncleanness. This word was first used in Paul's culture, a word that would describe the pus that would run from a wound that had been infected. In the moral sense, it refers to that which contaminates others and is repulsive, and that which is disgusting. Paul uses this term in the 19th verse in the 4th chapter as he refers to the ungodly behavior of Gentiles who had given themselves over to our word sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. This word would refer to what we would call perverted forms of sex. Perversion. Such as homosexuality, child abuse, bestiality. It would cover these words with the word impurity. Paul also in Romans chapter 1 verse 24, he links the whole activity of homosexuality to that word. It's disgusting, it's perverted. That's what the Bible says. Yeah, we can love them, witness to them, pray for them. But the acts of sexual relations is perverted. That's what the Bible says. I can't teach that which is politically correct.
That's right.
I'm not going to teach that which is socially accepted. Mm. What does the Bible teach us?
Yes.
Now, the rest is left up to you.
Amen.
You don't have to believe it.
That's true.
That's up to you. Jesus. You don't have to receive it. You can walk away and gather your own thoughts and put in your own innuendos and your own words. You can do that. That's up to you. But let it be said, that's going to be between you and God, because it had been delivered to you.
That's right.
This day.
That's right.
Even though this wasn't the first day, but it has been delivered to you this day to what this text means.
Yes. Amen.
Now, notice what Paul links up with impurity. And we just saw, you probably missed it, over in the 4th chapter, verse 19. Did you see a word that was tied to impurity in verse 19? Chapter 4. Yes, sir. Greediness. Greediness. Now he's going to tie greediness now again with impurity. I want you to see this. the next word he says, but immorality or any impurity or greed. Now, here's the meaning of this word greed in our text today. It means overreaching. Now, you usually don't think of overreaching when you think of greed. When we talk about greed, generally speaking, people think about money. They think about coveting money. Am I correct? We talk about greed. But it has a broader reaching meaning than just that. In this context, it means to have a sensual desire or love, or you are reaching over that which is not yours to desire or to lust for. It means to have an appetite, to have a strong lust, to satisfy the appetite of your body and your soul for that which is not yours. I believe that and that concept is taken right from the Ten Commandments. All your enthusiasm is just taking me to another level today. I believe this concept is seen elder in the Ten Commandments. In the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20, verse 17. Exodus chapter 20, verse number 17. Exodus 20 and verse 17. The word of God says, you shall not covet your neighbor's house, nor shall you covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. One of the things that God says you were not supposed to covet was your neighbor's wife. Your neighbor's wife. Let's go back to our text. Paul says, in greed, impurity, in greed, overreaching. Greed. Now, notice what Paul says about these three sins. What were the three sins? Are y'all still with me?
Mm-hmm.
I know y'all wishing it was almost 12 o'clock. I got 30 something on me. What are the three sins?
Immorality,
impurity, and greed. Now, let me see if you see who's tracking it. When you talk about immorality, he's talking about what?
Pornea.
Of sexual sins. When he talks about impurity,
perversions
of those sexual sins, which include but not limited to homosexuality. And when he talks about greed, overreaching for strong lust, overreaching for that which is not yours. And once all of this is tied in together, the same subject matter. Paul is not bringing in three different subjects. He's talking about the same subject matter. We are to walk as God walks. We are to walk in love. We are to walk in the God kind of love because he told us to imitate God. But to imitate God, we must not walk as the world walks. This is how the world walks. This is a different walk from the world. The world walks not in the love of God. Their love is saturated with lust, with immoralities, with impurities, with greed. These are the three sins that he lists. He said, but now you get this. He said, this must not even be named among you. This must not even be named among you. Christian, can I talk to you for a minute? Let me get down. Can I talk to you for a minute? You know, there are certain things that shouldn't even be named among us.
Amen.
This is why for the majority part, Christians, when a person becomes a Christian, they abstain from drinking, from smoking, from coarse language. Come on, some of us do that. Some of us continue on living like we live. Devil, truth, shame, the devil. Because the bottom line is, saints, can we be truthful? You know, what goes on behind closed doors is a lot different than what goes on here in this room. None of us know how any of us are really living.
That's true.
That became so apparently clear to my wife and I this week, ministering to others. We don't know what's happening behind closed doors.
Amen.
We simply try to pray for one another. Mm-hmm. And we pray that everyone, we pray that all of us is on the same page. Mm-hmm.
Right.
What we mean by the same page? That you're reading the same book that we're reading, and you have basically the same belief system toward the book as I have. Because then you expect a certain kind of behavior coming from me.
That's right. Living the life.
You would be totally, utterly shocked, mad, disgusted if you heard that I was beaten on Elder Faith. You said you wish I would.
No, I said you should.
Oh, okay. I'm going to ask you what you thought.
Okay.
But the bottom line is, we expect a certain behavior to come from uniformly in this place because we say that we are believers.
Yes.
We believe that Jesus died for us.
Yes.
We believe in the Bible.
Yes.
And so there's a uniformity, there's a unity in what we expect.
Amen.
And like I said, that's why we refrain from certain things.
That's true. That's right. Man.
Certain things should not even be named among us as Christians.
That's true. Amen.
It shouldn't even come up in the conversation.
That's right.
That's what he's talking about.
Mm.
Now, in his case, he's saying immoralities, he's saying impurity, he's saying greed, he's saying the saints at Ephesus, this should not even be named among you guys. We have the totality of scripture, so that list kind of broads out. And I'm just telling you, saints, that certain things shouldn't be even named among us.
Amen.
If we're having issues, we have what's called the Holy Spirit within us.
Amen.
Does anybody have the Holy Spirit?
Amen.
Does anybody have a working Holy Spirit?
Amen.
You know, there's a difference, Sister Carla. Everybody say they got the Holy Spirit, but it's not a working Holy Spirit. But for those who have a Holy Spirit that's not dormant, he ministers to us. He let us know when eye gate going wrong, ear gate messing up,
that's right.
Mouth gate, y'all ain't talking to me.
That's true.
When foot is going wrong, hand is going, it's called the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And then we come to church and the Word, don't talk about how the Word gets us. And what are we supposed to do when we come in contact with all of that? We're supposed to repent.
Repent.
Is there anything wrong with repenting?
No.
No.
Sure.
But how many believers repent?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's true.
We should all repent because none of us are perfect.
That's right.
We cross over the line. We are to repent of these actions. Mm-hmm. The bottom line, there are certain things that shouldn't even be named among us. It should bother us to hear of individuals who claim to be Christians who are operating in these areas of immorality.
Yes.
Should lead us to the point of praying that God would bring them to the point of repentance, seeking repentance, because it should not even be named among a Christian community. You see it and you know it. You as a believer, I believe you and I have a responsibility to go under the leadership of the Holy Spirit in the spirit of love and to go and address it. This is not befitting a Christian. Who are you to tell me what's not befitting a Christian? I am a child of God, and according to his word, it should not even be mentioned.
Jesus.
The reason why I believe there's such a high level of immorality, because those who do believe the Bible and do seek to put it into practice in our home, we keep our mouths shut. When we see and when we hear others operating in this, we don't want to rock the boat. We don't want people mad at us. I must be talking to somebody. We got an awful silence right there. We don't want, because you know, everybody got a right to interpret Christianity their own way, Pastor. This is why we live in a very subjective world today. Christianity is not subjected to your will. Christianity is not subjected to your interpretation. God has a described interpretation of every word that he penned through one of his 40 authors over a span of 1,500 years in 3 major languages. God is the author of this word. God penned a word through a particular individual. It was for a particular purpose and a particular reason. And it behooves us to find that reason, not left up to your subjectivity. Although we live in a world today that emphasizes, you know, you are the word of God is subject to your experience. Your Christian walk is subject to your experience. And everybody should to respect everybody's experience. When it comes to this word, it's not subjective. It is objective. It is objective. This word is objective, not subjective. It is the object of God. It is the mind of God, the heart of God, the ways of God, the word of God. It's not subject to our will. So you're going to come across individuals in your workplace, in your community, even in your home family. You're going to tell you, oh, that's old school. You're old folk. Your preacher's old. You need to get with the new program. This is a new day. This is a modern day. It's not limited to those old boundaries. Jesus. It's wide open to what you think.
Jesus.
That's the sin of existentialism.
Jesus.
That was brought in the late 40s, early 50s, that have filtered our school system. Now it has filtered our churches where we have no absolutes.
Jesus.
We live in the world with no absolutes. We watch television programs that have no absolutes.
Jesus.
That's why the haves and have-nots is getting worse and worse and worse. And so some of us, we can't wait till the new season comes. Those of you who watch Greenleaf got the mess all up in the church house.
Big mess.
And spread, and more Christians, believers, watch that mess. The only thing to do, it plants a seed in your head.
Yes, it does.
And we laugh at it. It becomes funny. And when it becomes funny, we have pity with it. And then when we have pity with it, we embrace it.
So sad.
That's the work of the enemy. That's the way the enemy works. Amen, Pastor.
Amen, Pastor.
Amen, Pastor. You know what you're preaching it today?
Amen, Pastor.
You're preaching it today, Pastor. I don't care what your congregation is. I want to let you know, brother. I want to know, brother, man, you own it today.
Amen.
You own it. You own it. As proper among saints, those who identify with Christ, those who said they are saints, where saints be separated.
That's right.
Saints, those who are named among the elect of God, saints, those who have been redeemed, saints, those who were once born in sin and shaped in iniquity, but God called us out. Saints!
Amen.
That which is proper among saints.
Yes.
Holy ones. Look at verse 4. Go back to your text. And there must be no. Now we just got through talking about the sexual sins. But there must be no. And then we get another list. Y'all ready?
Mm-hmm.
It's right here in the text. Don't want me to skip this verse.
No.
Don't want me to skip this verse.
No.
We can go on to, I think the next section is dealing with life. Just skip this verse and just move on. You gotta be crazy, Pastor Jay.
Nah.
What does verse 11 say? It says, there must be no filthiness or silly talk or coarse jesting which are not fitting. Now let's talk about these three words. How much time do I have? Let's talk about these three words. I got 15 minutes. Let's talk about these words. There must be no filthiness. The word filthiness here, it refers to that which is indecent, obscenities, shameful speech. Comes from a word that gives the connotation of speech that is disgraceful. I think this would fall in the category of individuals who like to entice each other with pictures of themselves over the phone.
Yeah.
what we call today sexting.
Why y'all looking at me like y'all never heard of those terms?
This is a 21st century term.
Sexting.
Filthiness, obscenity. That which is shameful. There must be no sin at all. We get our English word moron from the Greek word here. It's the root. You recall in the Bible says the fool is not someone who is mentally deficient, but rather a moron or a fool is one who is morally deficient because they ignore God's word. And in this context, Paul is referring to speech that disregards or makes light of God's moral commands. There must be no coarse jesting, which means to turn easy. To turn easy. Now, what does that mean, to turn easy, Pastor Jay? It's like, have you ever been in a conversation with someone and you make quite an innocent comment, but they're quick to catch on to it and turn it into something else? I know some individuals like that. And you go away thinking, how come I can't never think that quick? Maybe you have to. Sometimes I think like that. How come I can't think of that? And sometimes I don't get it till 4 hours later. I'm at home. And all of a sudden, I don't get it. I'm slow in that regard. This is what he's talking about, this coarse jesting. Someone who takes conversation, takes phrases, and makes something crass out of it. It's double talk. It's innuendos, thank you. It's turning something into a dirty joke, a off-color humor statement. It's what most of our stand-up comedians do. And what most of our TV sitcoms do. Christians should not joke. And regarding our particular context, Christians should not joke about sexual immorality. We should not expose ourselves to conversation that makes light of it. Amen. But rather, the text says, giving of thanks. Now, one would think that Paul would say that we are to replace sexual immorality with purity. That's true, and Paul will say that when we get down to verse number 9. But here he said that the alternate to sexual immorality and greed is simply to give thanks. Why does he say that? Why does thankfulness? What in the world does being thankful have to do with sexual impurity? Sexual immorality and all this impurity begins within us. It begins within. Jesus said that which proceeds out of man is born within the heart of man. Paul sees that the reason we venture into these sins and into these kind of speech habits is that we are not content with the provisions that God has given us. So we covet to that which leads to these sins. We want something else. Our life is so dull as a Christian. I want some humor, some off-color humor. Ain't nothing wrong with me going to a comedy club. Even though they're cussing up a storm, every other word is this, is that. Degrading our God. And we're sick of that because we want a little entertainment. Ain't nothing wrong with that, Pastor. I beg to differ. You are planting, you are allowing certain seeds to come into your head. Whether you have to go to the club or you turn to one of the HBO television stations or Showmax or whatever it is and look at those stand-up comedians and watch them go through their routine. Exposing ourselves to it. Paul says, be thankful for where you're at and what you got. Paul telling us to redirect and be thankful for what God has given us, for where we're at. Instead of coveting something else, instead of coveting someone else's, instead of wishing we were in the next person's yard with the greener grass, be grateful for your little brown patches. See Brother Jerry at the end of the service and asked him what kind of weed you control. Am I talking to somebody?
Amen.
All that you're saying, be thankful. Be thankful. Be thankful for your spouse. Be thankful for what you got. Be thankful that he called you and saved you. Even though you think your life is boring, be thankful. Be thankful. Be thankful. You can pray and he answers your prayer. Be thankful. He keeps meeting your need. Be thankful. Don't go overreach and try to get something that don't belong to you. Be thankful for your job. Even though you think you should be making more, be thankful. Be thankful. Be grateful.
Amen.
Grateful. Paul says, filtering the silly talk, coarse jestings, which are not fitting, but rather the giving of thanks. For this you know with certainty, that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. This is the verse that has caused much misunderstanding in the body of Christ. Because the thought is, if Paul is talking to Christians, and if Christians have salvation and can't lose it, then what is he talking about when he says, for this you know with certainty, that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Paul is simply making the distinction. He is not, that particular verse is not making reference to believers. If one is immoral, if their life is categorized by immorality, in other words, this is something that they do on a daily basis. This is something that they practice on a regular basis. Immorality, an impure person or covetousness, man. Notice the endings of this word. This is a man, this is a person whose lifestyle is this mess. This person is not saved. This person is not a believer. He said, one who operates in this shall not, will not, cannot inherit the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Well, someone was saying, but Justin, well, isn't heaven going to be full of sinners? And I would have to, the first part of that, I would have to say, yes, but sinners who have been redeemed.
Yeah.
Yes. It will be full of sinners, sinners who have been saved by the grace of God, whose lives have been changed by the power of the Holy Ghost. We made a conscious decision. I won't walk in this way. I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. The old have passed away. And behold, all things. It's all things.
Yes.
Have become new.
Yes.
Amen.
So he goes on. He says, let no one deceive you with empty words. Why? He said, let no one deceive you. Because he said, there are going to be folks in the church, Brother Mike, who's going to claim that they all this and that and holy and thou, and they're operating in this sexual pure, this sexual cesspool with all of this kind of talk. He said, don't let them fool you and deceive you in thinking that they are Christians and that they are believers and that you need to pay any attention to what they say. Don't let no one deceive you. For because of these, how you know he said, because when he said because of these things, because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. They hear the word, but they don't want to adhere to the word. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. Can I get somebody beside my first row here? Read that with me.
Therefore,
do not
be
partakers with them. Now, who are the them? Who are the them, sister? Who are the them? Well, the unbelievers. The unbelievers. the unbelievers. Can I stay with my text? Can we stay with our text? Who are them? The sons of disobedience. That's another good one. Who else? Who are them? Those who operate in filthiness and silly talk and coarse jesting. Who are them? We get there. Who else belongs to them? Not so in the text here. Those who operate in immorality, impurity, and greed. So immorality, impurity, greed, filthiness, silly talk, coarse jesting. Those who try to deceive us into thinking that they're Christians and their lifestyle is totally different. Jesus said, you know a tree by its fruit.
That's right.
You know a tree by its fruits. You know a tree by its fruits. Thank you. Thank you. Therefore, do not be partakers. Therefore, do not be partakers. Do not be partakers. Do not be partakers. Don't operate them as if what they're doing is okay. Be one who speak up. That's not the way Christians behave. That's not the way Christians talk.
That's right. Amen.
Christians don't operate like that. Do you mind if I have a word with you? I just want to share some good news from the Word of God. I heard you a few minutes ago, and I'm so glad to hear that you say that you're a Christian, but I just want to share with you, Christians don't talk like that. I saw what you was doing over there, and I was amazed that you claim to be a Christian. I hear you sometimes, but I just want to share with you that Christians don't behave like that. Come on, sit down here and have lunch with me. No, I would love to share a word with you, but I cannot be in the midst of this cesspool and y'all joking and talking and lying and you're gossiping and you're talking all about this sexual innuendo and this and that. No, I'll sit over here by myself. Thank you. Thank you for the invite. No, I can't come over, bro. I can't come over, brother. I know y'all say I like to kind of isolate myself from the family, but I tell you what, see, I picked up on some stuff when I come around y'all. Y'all want to talk about this television program, and y'all get to cussing, and you get to drinking and acting all ugly and acting all crazy. And talking about that. No. Oh, you think you're too good. You think you're better than us. No, I'm just a Christian. You can classify it any way you want. I'm a Christian, and I don't wish to put myself into that environment. Do not be partakers.
Amen.
Do not be partakers.
Amen.
Do not partake with them. I'll pick up with verse number 8 next week.
Amen.
That's verse 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7.